Heavenly Father God, tonight, we love you, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, for the song. We thank you for the testimony to God. Most of all, God, we thank you for your presence here tonight. Lord, what would we be? What would the church be, Lord, without your presence, Father? And God, we never fail to, Lord, just invite your presence, the Jesus and the Holy Spirit, Father. We just thank you for it. And Father, we pray tonight, God, that you open up every heart, every mind, every soul here tonight, God. And God, for those who are not here tonight, God, I pray that you'll touch them and, Lord, minister to them. God, you don't see their needs. You know why they're not here, Father. But God, I pray that those who are here tonight, you will bless them, Lord, and lift them up, Lord. And God, we will never fail to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. And we thank you, Lord, for your presence tonight, Jesus. And everybody says, amen. 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 Now, I'm going to preach on tonight. The Holy Ghost will make you into another person. I said the Holy Ghost will make you into another person. Yeah. Now, I want you to know something tonight. If you're saved, I said if you're saved tonight, I believe they're all saved here tonight. Not you can't be. You can't get no savior than that. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
But I'm going to preach on a man tonight that he was an Israelite. He was one of the Jews. He was under the covenant of God. He was in the kingdom. He had all the blessings and everything. But God, you know, when God calls us, now God was about to call this man that I'm going to preach on tonight. He had the blessings. He had the covenant. He was under the, he's a citizen of Israel. He had all the things going for him that God wanted Israel to, amen, to people have. But there's one thing that God had to do for him. Because God was going to call him into, amen, to use him. I don't care whether you're a savior or a witness or whoever you are, even though you're saved, and the Bible says when we get saved, we're new creatures. How many know you're new creatures? You're a new person. But yet we still need to realize that when God calls us into his kingdom, he has a job and a work for us to do. In order for us to do that work, God has got to anoint us. Can I say that again?
Amen.
And that anointing will cause us to, amen, to really to be another person. A person that God can use through the Holy Ghost. And church, let me tell you something. I believe with all my heart, we need to have that in the midst of the church. Like I teach this morning in their Sunday school, I believe that for every time that God's people need to get back, and I tell you, the New Testament church, on the day of Pentecost, from there on, they illustrated how important the Holy Ghost was. And I thank God for that tonight. But God calls us into a job or into ministry or whatever. He wants us to have that anointing upon our lives. You got to have that anointing. Even to be a witness or whatever, you got to have it. You got to be that different person that only the Holy Spirit can do. And the Bible says down in chapter 10, verse 1, then Samuel took the veil of oil and poured it upon his head, Samuel, and kissed him and said, It is not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be the captain over his. This is what he says now. He said, is it not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be captain over his inheritance? In other words, he was going to be the king of Israel. And therefore, he needed God's anointing, amen, to cause him to be that different person that he needed to be. And church, God has called us into the kingdom and to do a work for him. And we need the same blessing upon us. Can I hear an amen? And the Bible tells us in verse 2, when thou art departed from me today, then thou shalt find two men by Rachel's servant in the border of Benjamin at Sisera, and they will say unto thee, the asses which thou wentest to seek are found, and lo, thy father hath left the cure of thy asses and sorrow for you, saying, what should I do for my son? Then shalt thou go on forward from thence, and thou shalt come to a plain of Tabor, and there shall meet three men going up to God to Bethel, one carrying in thee three kids, and another carrying three loaves of bread, and another carrying a bottle of wine. and they will salute thee and give thee two loaves of bread, which thou shalt receive of their hands, and after that shalt come to the hill of God, where is the garrison of the Philistines. And it shall come to pass, when thou art come farther to the city, that thou shalt meet a company of prophets coming down from the high places, with psaltery and tabret and pipe and harp before them, and they shall prophesy, and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shall be turned into another man. Now see, we got to remember something first, like I said a while ago. The Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 21, we got to remember this, how Saul was. Now, first of all, he was an alien. He was an alien from the covenant of Israel. He was a stranger from the covenants and promise, and having no hope and without God. See, he had all these, but he needed that anointing upon his life to be the king of Israel. God was calling Saul into the kingdom of Israel. Thank God now, because of Jesus, we can have that anointing for our lives, because we're in the kingdom of God, we're in the citizenship, we have hope of God, but yet we need that anointing upon us, just as Saul did. We need that, amen, the oil to pour upon us, that we can be used for God's kingdom. Now the Bible teaches us, first of all, that he will change your walk. Now, if you read the life of Saul, as long as he had the Spirit upon him, the anointing upon him, he was a different man. I mean, God used him tremendously because he had the Holy Spirit upon him and that anointing. And when the enemy come against him or whatever, the Holy Ghost would come in and take charge, and he couldn't be defeated. So that's what we need tonight, church. I believe with all my heart, he can change us. Now, the first thing we need to learn, as I teach in the Sunday school this morning, I know the church, if there is an outward appearance or outward sign, amen, of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will change us, and let the church know that you got the anointing upon your life. But the church needs a sign just like we need a sign. The Bible said they prophesied upon him, and when he prophesied, he was actually used by the Spirit of God and was turned into another man. Now, church, we need to have a walk, amen, with God, and be able to do a work for God the way God wants us to work. Now, how many know the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13, that, you know what, we can have faith, amen, to move mountains. We can have faith to do a lot of things. And even give ourselves. But if we don't, first of all, don't have the love of God, and church, the Holy Spirit will give us a walk of love. And if there's every time in our churches today, we need the walk of love. Yes. Now, church, let me tell you, it will cause the churches, love will keep the church from splitting up. Can I hear an amen? Church will cause us to have unity. And this is the job of the Spirit, because the Bible says, if we walk in the Spirit, we'll not fulfill what the lust. Amen. So therefore, I believe with all my heart, in order, amen, that God really use us in the ministry, we've got to have that anointing. Because if we've got that anointing upon our lives, we're going to walk in the Spirit of love. And church, the love of God will change you. It'll cause people, amen, to recognize that you have something in you, and they can feel the love and feel the presence of God. And church, I believe with all my heart, the churches are missing that. And church, I'm here, I want you to know something. Saul had the same problem that you and I had. Because when the Bible says when the God took his spirit away from him, he began to have a spirit really of Satan. He lost all of his love, amen, especially for David. A jealous spirit come upon him, a spirit of envy come upon him, and the Holy Ghost was there no longer to cause him to walk in the way that he ought to walk, because God withdrew that spirit. Church, I want you to know something now. We need the Holy Spirit and the anointing upon our lives. If, like I said many times, if Jesus had to have that anointing and have that presence of God upon him, we've got to have it also. I'd like to see a church, praise God, that is walking in love, where there's no bickering, where there's no unity, where we're together, we have a fellowship with one another. And church, it's going to take the Holy Spirit to give us that kind of love, amen, that we need as a fellowship in God's church. Now, the Bible tells us if we walk in the Spirit, we're going to be blessed of God. But if we walk in the flesh, amen, the God just can't use us. And I want to be used. How many wants to be used tonight? And truth be told, this is hard, amen, but if we've got the Holy Spirit of God, it will help us to walk in the love that we need to have. Too many church people today, I think I hear somebody saying that when he first got saved, now church be tell you, it was love was showing you. And he said, you know, when he said women were talking tongues and speaking everything, and they had the hateful spirit about them. Church, we got to have a good spirit about us, and the Holy Ghost will give us a good spirit. I have seen Holy Ghost people, sometimes I say, have they really got the Holy Ghost? Because they're so hateful and don't have no unity, but the Holy Ghost will cause us to have a walk, and a walk of love, a walk of unity. And church, I want you to know something. I believe God could use that kind of people. And sometimes, church, we need to check ourselves, and sometimes we just need to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 through 13. And church, I'm here to tell you, the Holy Spirit will check us and cause us to walk in that kind of love. And church, that the first thing the Bible tells us about the Spirit of God, it will fill us full of love. And for every time the church needs that, I believe it's now. And church, I want you to know, I want this church to be full of love. And church, I've heard people come out and say, you know what, Brother Maggard? You may not have a big church, but that church is full of love. That shows you the Spirit of God is moving in the church, and people's got the Spirit because the Spirit of God has loved it, and people will take notice of it, and church, they want to come back again. Can I hear an amen? But let's talk about the Spirit just for a moment, because I believe we need to pray, and the Holy Ghost will cause us. Now, the Bible tells us that he was changing to a different man. Now, first of all, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall fulfill the lust of the flesh. How many wants to fulfill the love of God? We don't want to walk in the flesh, do we? God delivers from the flesh, that's what it says. This I say, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, for the lust of the flesh, lust is against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you're led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, vanities, emulation, wrath, strife, and sedition, and hearsay, and envy, and murders, and drunkenness, and rebellion, just like they which I tell you before, as I have also told in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. What are you trying to say? I'm saying the Holy Spirit will check us, amen, that we can walk in the Spirit of love, and we won't have strife. We won't have all these things that Paul pointed out, because see, we're walking in the Spirit. When we begin to walk in the Spirit of God, amen, we're going to have first the Spirit of love, and love will cover every one of this that I just named. And church, I believe we're, as a church, all of us is coming up short, not having the Spirit of love in ourselves. Can I hear an amen? Amen. And we need to pray and seek God, because as you begin to check your spirit, are you having a problem with adultery? Are you having a problem with fornication? Are you having a problem with envy or murder or drunkenness or such of these things? If you're having these kind of problems, what you need to do is pray and ask God and fill you with, not with these, but fill you with the Spirit of love. Because church, I'm here to tell you, the Spirit of love will cause you to do great things for God. Saul done great things for God as he began to walk in the Spirit following God. But when he left the fellowship of God, the Spirit was taken from him. He began to have all these things here, amen, that we're talking about. If we've got the Spirit of God, this is what it said now, the Spirit of love. Now this is what the Spirit of love. The Spirit of love is joy, his peace, his long-suffering, his gentleness, his goodness, his faith, his meekness, his temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh within the affection of lust. If you live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. What are you trying to say, Brother Mike? This, the Holy Spirit will guide us through these things, and he will cause us to be a different person. Now, church, When I got saved, God put the Spirit of God in me. And when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, He put the Spirit of love in me that I could walk the way God wanted me to walk. And when I began to have that problem, guess what? I began to recognize I need to come to an old-fashioned altar and say, God, I want the Holy Ghost to fill me back up, because this temple of mine don't have no room for these things. Amen. That's coming against the Spirit of God. Fill me back with love. Fill me back with joy. Fill me back with peace. Fill me back with all these things. And church, I believe the Holy Ghost will do it. I believe God will do it. And we can have a better walk with God. Can I hear that? Amen. So the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, will change us into another person, will cause us to walk in love. Even though we may be saved, we still may have a problem with these things, because we don't have enough of the Holy Spirit and anointing upon of God upon us that we can conquer these things. It takes the Holy Spirit to conquer these things. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
It will change. It will change our worship. See, we need to have, as an individual, the Bible says, let us work out our own salvation with fear and tremble. Now, church, I can't tell you to shout. I can't tell you what I do sometimes, and you do it because you honor me, but you don't need to honor me, you need to honor God. And church, when you got a spirit of worship in you, and the Holy Ghost will give you a spirit of worship. Can I say that again? The Holy Spirit will give us a gift of worship that when we come to church, we don't have to be told to do something. Can I hear an amen? Because you will have a testimony. You will have a song. You will have a witness. You will have a joy. You will have a worship. And church, the churches are missing that today. Are you listening to what I'm saying? I can remember when I first got saved, when people really began to was walking in the Holy Spirit. Now, that's over probably 50 years ago. And how time has changed over the last 50 years. And church, I mean, they know how, when they come to church, they knew how to worship God. I said they knew how to worship God, and they wasn't ashamed to worship God, because see, they had a person in them which was the Holy Spirit, and that they let the Holy Spirit worship through them and in them, and they had no trouble lifting up their hands. They didn't have no trouble if they felt like shout. If they felt like testifying, they'd testify. Why? Because they had a spirit of worship in them. And church, I thank God for the service this morning, because we had people this morning worshiping the Spirit, and the Holy Ghost was leading them. And church, you can feel God's Spirit all through the church. And this is the kind of spirit that God wants us to have in the churches today. Oh, church, we come a long way, but we've left the Holy Spirit behind us. We come to a place that, as the Bible says in the book of Acts, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? Church, we need to get back and get filled back up, walk in the Spirit of love, and have a worship about us, and we won't be ashamed. I said we won't be ashamed to worship God. Oh, we need to get back to that. We need to get back to the old past where they used to worship God. Oh, you listen to what I'm saying? Because church, they come to church. They didn't come to be seen. They didn't come to be heard. They come to worship Jesus.
Amen.
Now, church, when you get Holy Ghost in your life, I'm going to tell you, you will glorify Jesus. It's all about Jesus. I said, I'm about to get happy now. Because He'll put a dance in your feet, glory to God. He'll put something in your hand. And the Bible says, lift up those hands and them on knees, praise God. In other words, when you got a place that you can't go no farther, just lift your hands up, let the Holy Ghost take charge. And I guarantee you'll be a different person.
Amen.
Oh, give the Lord a hand clap. Holy Ghost will change you. I know for a fact. Sometimes I come to church, I hurt all over and everything else, get hard at walk and everything. But oh, when that inner man takes over. I said, when that inner man takes over, I feel like a young chick. I mean, I feel like a young person. I feel like a different person. I may feel hurt and everything after I get down. Amen. Worshiping God. But church is worth every bit of it. It kind of reminds me of when I get to heaven, because I won't have no aches and I won't have no pains. And I can continue to worship Jesus. Church, this will be the quietest place in the world right now, because when we get to heaven, we're going to worship Him. We're going to praise Him. We're going to glorify Him, church. And we will know how to worship Him. I'll give the Lord a hand for that, church. This is just a place where we can learn to, amen, to worship God. This is what the Bible says. See, the Bible says God is a spirit.
Yeah.
And that worship, we must worship in spirit and truth. Oh, let the Holy Ghost just take over your life. Oh, for every time that we need the Holy Ghost to take over our lives just now.
Amen.
God can do a work that we can imagine.
Amen.
That's in John chapter 4, verse 24. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. But him therefore let us offer the sacrifices of praise continually. Now what that means, church, just don't wait till we get to church, amen, to give him a sacrifice. Don't wait till we get to church to worship him. Are you listening to what I'm saying? If you begin to praise him and worship him, now church, what I'm saying to them old time Pentecostal people, them old holiest people in Kentucky, when I was just a young man, they didn't drive for 2 or 3 miles. They walked for 2 or 3 miles. And church, it wasn't no problem for them. You know why? There was an inner man given the strength because you could hear them worshiping God and praising him from one hillside to other hillside. Why? Because they knew how to worship God and they knew how to praise God. And that 2 or 3 miles didn't seem like nothing. Could you imagine us walking to church for 2 or 3 miles? We can't even drive to church for 2 or 3 miles. Can I hear an amen? Church, I want you to know some praise God. We need to know how to worship God. I said, let us praise God continually. That means when we're at home or when we're at work or when we're job or when we're doing the dishes or cooking or whatever. We need to learn to praise and let the Holy Ghost, amen, to get to lift up Jesus and praise him. And I tell you, church, you will be a different person. I'll give the Lord a hand clap, church. Only the Holy Ghost, only that anointing can change you. But him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifices of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips. That's a sermon by itself. But you go back on the fruits of the Spirit. Begin to preach on that because your lips have got a lot of problems. Hello, I'm not going to go there, but I said your lips will give you a whole lot of problems. Amen. Praise God continue. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. The Bible tells us now. See, when you don't have that anointing, and I've seen singers, I've seen preachers, I've seen people that testify, I've seen all these people, amen. You can have a mouth testimony. You can sing with it, even though you don't have anointing before in your life. You can do some of these things. But let me tell you something. God knows if we got the right spirit or not.
Amen.
See, the Bible says we got to worship God's spirit in truth. What does that mean? I'm worshiping God in my heart. I said I'm worshiping God in my heart. The Bible said that they would worship them with their lips, amen, and with their mouth, but their heart was far from it. When we begin to worship God through the Holy Spirit, we're worshiping God in the heart. And the Holy Spirit works in our hearts, and God works in our heart, and he can tell if we really got what we need to have and what we got we can share to somebody else. Church, I want you to know I thank God. I don't want to worship God just with my lips and with my mouth, but I want that spirit to come out of me, that he would go from breast to breast and breath. When you've got a testimony that's anointed with God, if you got a song that's anointed with God, if you got preaching anointed with God, it will go somewhere. I said it will go somewhere. It will go to reach that heart, amen, that needs a touch. Can I hear an amen? Oh, glory to God. Oh, how we need this. Churches are dying. I said they're drying up. They're about as dead as last year's bird nest. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Now, church, a lot of times people can sing for an hour or two and everything else. You don't have to sing for 2 or 3 hours. If you've got something in you, you don't have to sing for 2 or 3 hours. You don't have to worship for 2 or 3 hours to get heaven come down. You need to have it in you when you come to church. I said, the Bible said, praise him continually. And church, that's what he means. He said, when you come to church, praise him when you're coming, praise him when you're there, and praise him when you're going home. I'll give the Lord a hand clap, church. Oh, glory to God. Saul had to be turned into another person. Even though he had all the things that a Jew had, all the covenants, all the promises, and God was with him. But he had to have that anointing for the job that God was giving him. God has given every one of us a job. You say, what kind of job you that God has given him? I don't know what job God has given. Well, the Bible says, first of all, you need to be a witness.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
If you've got that new man in you, that man, you will have a witness. You will stand up boldly and worship God and say, you know what? I thank God I've got Jesus.
Amen.
I tell you, they had a time to keep me quiet at work. It's a lot of times, Sister Peggy, I tell you, I had to wash myself because I was always getting in trouble because you know why? I was lifting up Jesus. Some of them wouldn't be me because they had something to go by. And church, let me tell you something. They can say what they want to. I don't know what the old saying said, that stay versus the Christian or whatever. Christianity was here but long before the law was.
Amen.
Oh, thank God for that. Praise God. But the Bible tells us in Mark chapter 7, verse 6 and 7, I don't want to be none of these. I want to be a true worshiper. I want to worship God from my heart. Like that song said, my soul is well. As long as you know your soul is well, it's in tune with God and the Holy Spirit, you're going to be all right. But as we look in Mark chapter 7, verse 6 and 7, well has Isaiah the prophet prophesied of the you hypocrites. What he says, you hypocrites. In other words, they're actors, they're pretenders. As is written, this people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in the vain do they worship me. Church, I thank God we got something real tonight. I saw some real things this morning.
Amen.
I see some people, amen, worshiping God the way they want to worship God. Amen. Because they had a touch from heaven and they come, amen, to be touched. Some were down, some were brokenhearted, some had different ideas and things in their life and everything. But they learned to lay it aside and get in and worship Jesus and praise Him and let the Holy Spirit come in and bless them the way that they ought to be blessed. And they begin to worship God in their hearts. And when you worship God in your heart, God will bless you.
Amen.
And God will anoint you. And God will use you. See, God wants everybody in this sanctuary and everybody that's hearing my voice tonight. Amen. God wants to use you. But He can't use you until He makes you into another person. And that gives you anointing upon your life. And only God, the Holy Spirit, can do that. I said, only the Holy Spirit can do that because you've got to have the Holy Ghost anointing upon your life. If Jesus had to have that anointing, we've got to have it.
Amen.
If you read Acts 10, 13, it'll tell you how God used Jesus Christ, filled him with the Holy Ghost and power, and used him to heal, used him to preach, used him to anoint him in all these things that he does because God was with him. Oh, give the Lord a hand clap. See, we're living in time. I'm trying to hurry, but we're living in time. And the Bible said John the Baptist was received the Holy Ghost in his mother's womb. And the Holy Ghost, even the Holy Ghost in his life, caused him to do the most important thing. See, the Bible teaches us. Now, I know God, he anoints us, and we can have glory and everything. But we first of all got to glorify God. But in order to receive that anointing and receive it and have that vessel appointed in your life, that's to be full. You know what the Bible teaches? It says you've got to decrease while Jesus increases. In other words, you've got to empty yourself out that you get full of the Holy Spirit, that you can have the anointing and the touch of Jesus in your life, that you may what? You may glorify Him. Everything that we do, when it comes to anything in the church, it should be for one purpose and one purpose only, to glorify Jesus that is in you through the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit can be used the way it ought to be, and you have that anointing upon your life, you will glorify Jesus in everything that you do.
Amen.
Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
When I get up and preach church, I've been preaching for probably, 40 years, Sister Magda, or something like that. I still get sweaty hands. I still have that trembling. You know why? Because I know I can't do nothing without Jesus and it can't do nothing without the Holy Ghost. I've got to rely upon Him. And I wouldn't give you nothing for a singer or for or a preacher or a teacher, whatever, that didn't have that feeling about them, because if you can't get rid of yourself, how can the Holy Spirit use you? Every service I pray and to have God, amen, when I get to sermon, everything, I have anointing up on my life, amen, as I preach, I have that up because I know I can't do nothing without Him. And I appreciate it when the congregation said that you've done a good job and done a good preach. That's good, you know what? But you know what I say? I give Jesus the glory for it. Because you know what, church? That's what it's all about. I don't want to be seen. I want Jesus to be seen. Can I hear an amen? Oh, glory to God. We've got so much flesh in the churches anymore. I said we've got so much flesh anymore. A lot of these preachers and all these singers and everything they got, they're not in it for God. They're in it for themselves and in it for the money. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
We might as well tell the truth about it, church.
Right.
Bible says in John chapter 3, verse 30, he must increase, but I must decrease. John 16:13 said, Jesus can't be hid. This is what the Bible says in John 16:13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. See, we need that anointing upon our lives. So because he will guide us into the truth. That's what the Bible says. For he shall not speak of himself, but whosoever shall hear it. But whosoever shall hear him that shall speak, he will show you things to come, and he shall glorify me. Now, church, that's how you can tell if a person has really got the anointing upon their life. They're not trying to glorify themselves, but they're trying to glorify Jesus. It's okay to be a singer. It's okay to be a musician. It's okay to be a teacher, whatever. But when you're trying to glorify yourself, are you listening to what I'm saying? You're not giving God the glory, and you're not being used of the Holy Spirit. And in closing tonight, it will change your outlook about the kingdom. I said it will change your outlook about the kingdom. See, the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 2 and 9, and this is what we want to look at. Bible said, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has entered the heart of man what God has in store for them. But now this is what he says. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Without the Holy Spirit in our life, the anointing of our life, we couldn't actually see the big, deep things of God. I mean, God can show you things. There's still things that God can reveal to his people if we just get full of God's Spirit and get in a place where we can have a relationship with God. God can show us things that would cause us to be mind-boggled.
Sure.
Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Church, we need the anointing in our lives. We need the Holy Ghost in and on our lives. Just get self out of the way, empty ourselves, and get filled back up. If you don't have the Holy Ghost tonight, now church, we used to preach this all the time. When I was growing up about 50 years ago, every service was the Holy Ghost. Jesus was the Savior. The Holy Ghost was a baptizer. You had to have it and everything. He's a sanctifier. He's a dedicator. He's a counselor. He's everything. Then the first two things they preached every service, they didn't preach other things. But them things were the main theme of the service. How far have we come, church? Because you never hear about the Holy Spirit and the anointing that we have to have to do a work for God.
Amen.
I want to feel God, don't you?
Amen.
I want to feel God. Would you stand tonight?